Good evening, everyone. Now we are starting our session. So before moving ahead in our session, I would like to confirm that am I audible to everyone and my screen is visible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
okay,
sir.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you for your confirmation. Moving to the core session, I would like to give a brief introduction about our company. So our company is called State Modeler. I am Hiren Kakkar, CEO and co-founder of this company. So basically how this idea came in my mind that to open this company is like I was working as a management consultant, and I used to go to the various companies where we do some improvement projects and everything. But in the company, what I feel is like, whether it is a company or research project or anything, but they are collecting plenty of data, but they are struggling with what are the tools and techniques to be used to convert those data into decision making. So that that gap was identified, and then I started this company in 2019. And we have four domains of services. So first domain is of data science, where we are providing training and consultancy for the data science subjects like machine learning, R, RStudio, then Python, SPSS, Minitab, Power BI, Tableau, and everything. And the second domain is operational excellence, where we are using this blended approach of operational excellence concepts like Six Sigma, 5S, Kaizen, Lean, TPM, and everything. Because this blended approach will be required, increase the speed of implementation. Otherwise, like in same company, it is not necessary that all the department will require Six Sigma or all the department require that 5S. So in some of the department, in some of the areas, Six Sigma is required. In some of the areas, 5S is required. So likewise, we used to have a customized approach so that speed of implementation will be increased. The third is a research project where we are sharing our expertise in the research projects, maybe sponsored by the government, maybe sponsored by the private universities, colleges, or it may be individual research projects. So for example, if somebody is doing PhD and they also collected, they are also collecting a data and then they need some assistant. So in that also we are helping them. And the fourth domain where we are also collaborating with the universities and the colleges, and we used to conduct a workshop, training program, and certification courses for the faculties and the students. These are some of the areas where we worked. So you can see it is a wide range of area. It is not only a specific area where we are talking about only agriculture or manufacturing or only services. So you can see like agroeconomics, dairy economics, home science, mechanical engineering, pharmaceutical sciences, then plastic process industry, ceramic industry, everywhere. So these are all the concepts where, because in all this process, the common thing is data, because we are collecting data in every, domain. And why we are collecting the data? Because we want to convert them into decision making, or we want to make use of those collected data. So it is applicable everywhere, basically. These are some of the programs that we delivered. Obviously, it is before this lockdown. So we conducted training on this SPSS at BVM College of Engineering, then BSS at Department of Statistics, SP University. In the same department, we also conducted training on the Python. And this is also on a role of SPSS at DBU Nadiad. And these are all the snaps of the training on R that we provided. So at Mumbai University, AERC, Sardar Patel University, Gujarat University. So everywhere, we have provided this kind of training on R. We have also conducted online training. So till date after lockdown, during this 4 months, these are the training programs that we conducted. So every month we used to plan a number of training programs and then we execute that. So you can see more than 30 programs. This is the data up till September. So this is the programs that we delivered, and that is all on the different topics you can see. And let me introduce my team. So I am Hiren Kakkar, CEO and co-founder of this company. Then Mehul Gandhi, who is business associate with us. Then Saurabh Chaudhary, who is also business associate with us. Mr. Kapil Vanand, who is operating from UK. So he is also business associate with us. And Mr. Lalit Alone, he is also business associate with us. So this is our team. And we can proudly say we have all the products of Department of Statistics, Sardar Patel University. And this is the brief contact detail about us. So you can also follow us on YouTube, Facebook, and other social media platform. I'll also share the link for the YouTube, so you can subscribe to that channel, because this recording also we are going to upload on that channel. So that is the brief introduction about our company. Now let me give a short introduction about our today's speaker, trainer, Dr. Sandeep Rohadia ji. He is from the Germany, so he has connected from Germany all the way. So sir's background, there's a huge number of pages are there about his introduction, but the few of them I would like to share it with you. So sir did the Bachelor of Electrical Engineering and MBA specialization in IT from MSU Baroda. Then he did PhD in ERP implementation from GTU Ahmedabad. He also did master in data science from Bologna University, Italy. 20 years of corporate and business management teaching experience in reputed institute and the university within Germany as well as in India. He completed last assignment as a content manager for the training and community in Continental AG, Hanover, Germany. Currently, he is working as IT trainer and data analyst in Hanover, Germany. Sir has successfully conducted 28 plus webinars and workshops in last 4 months and trained more than 3,200 professionals, faculty members, and students in the area of big data, MS Power BI, Tableau, and Excel. Sir is also Microsoft certified Power BI professional, as well as he is also certified Tableau desktop specialist, certified Google Analytics professional, professional Scrum Master and product owner, and certified ITIL for professional. Sir has visited 15 plus European countries till date, and sir has acted as a consul of Hanover Professionals Networking, a group of international in Hanover. And sir is life member of BMA, that is Baroda Management Association, and Indian Society for Training and Development. Sir has received 5 awards for teaching excellence from the Institute of Reputation. So there is a long list of sir's achievement, but this is what I wanted to convey to you. Now I would like to hand over the session to Samir sir. Samir sir, can you please join with us and share your screen and carry on the session?
Yes sir, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
So I will share my screen.
Sir is sharing his screen. So meanwhile, I would like to tell you something, that at the end of this webinar, we'll have a question and answer session, and then I'll share one link with you to claim your certificate. So the people who will attend this full webinar, they will get the certificate. So be with us till the end. Yes, sir. Now your screen is visible. You can continue.
Okay, good. Great. So now I hope everybody is able to hear me and also see my full screen. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay. Yes. Thank you very much. So first of all, it is my great pleasure to get connected with Hiren sir. And just to give you a background, that I know Hiren sir since last almost now 10 years. And our first meeting was when I was working as a director in Parul University. And like in those days, it was not Parul University. I was working for the PGDM program. So at that time, I met Hiren sir, and we also had a workshop on, I think so, Six Sigma. And then we got connected with each other. And then since we are attached with each other. So definitely, it is my great pleasure to get associated with his company, that is Start Modular. And this is my first webinar with him, and definitely now this relationship will continue. And as sir has told, that at the end of this presentation, we'll be also announcing our upcoming workshop. So stay tuned till the end of this session here. Okay, so when people were joining in this session, so I saw that some of my ex-students are also there in the session, and also some of my ex-colleagues are also there. So I'm very happy to see all of you and also the other participants. So without wasting time, let us start with the main topic. So today we are having this topic known as Introduction to Big Data and Tableau. So let us start with it. Sir has already given my introduction very well, so I'm not going into it. Now the flow of presentation. So first of all, we'll see with this topic that is known as Introduction to Big Data. Then I'll be talking about the big data application areas. Then what are the different types of job roles which are there in big data. Then I'll be giving you some information about the Indian analytics market. Then a little bit about the European analytics market. And then finally, I'll be touching upon this Tableau topic. Now, before we go further in this presentation, so I would like to go with an assumption that like you are just a beginner in this big data. Yeah. So with that assumption, I'm going because so definitely I know that some of you must have already known a little bit about big data. Maybe you must have worked with Power BI or Tableau or those kind of thing. But to keep everyone on the same platform, so I'm going with this assumption. So if you have never heard about big data, so don't worry, I'll be starting from the scratch over here in this presentation. Now, first of all, we'll be starting with this quote, which says that information is the oil of the 21st century and analytics is the combustion engine. Now, before this quote, you must have also heard the another quote that is known as data is the new oil. So in relation to that, Hiren sir, I think so I'm able to hear some background noise. So it is.
Okay, let me mute the participants.
Okay. Good. Yeah. So we have already heard that the quote that is data is the new oil. And from that only, this person that is Peter Sondergaard, he is working in a company known as Gartner. Now we'll say come back to this Gartner company. So he says that information is the oil of the 21st century and analytics is the combustion engine. So here he is focusing, or he is giving importance to these two words, that is information as well as analytics. So currently what is happening that most of the companies, they are having a lot of data, but now having just data does not make any sense. Okay, we have to further do the analysis of the data. Now, as you know very well that if we analyze the data, we get information. And then if we analyze information, then we get knowledge out of it. So if information is the oil of the 21st century, then analytics is the combustion engine. We require some kind of engine to analyze this information. So what is that engine? That engine is known as analytics engine, yeah, or analytics simply, you can say data analytics. So this is what is this person is saying. Now let us start with the first topic that is known as Introduction to Big Data. Now here, a question may come in your mind that why currently we are talking about this big data? Yeah, so what is so special about it and why now only? So here you can see that this is a chart which is showing you that what is happening in 1 minute, or I would say 60 seconds on internet. And this is for 2020. Yeah. So in 1 minute or 60 seconds, you can see that on Facebook, 1.3 million logins are done. Then on YouTube, 4.7 million videos are viewed. Those who are my younger people, they know Tinder very well. So on Tinder, 1.6 million swipes are done. Yeah. Likewise for TikTok and all other things. Yeah. So here, if this is the situation in 1 minute, or I would say 60 seconds, then you can just imagine that what will happen in 1 hour or 1 day or 1 month or 1 year. So because of all these social media platforms plus our e-commerce websites, huge amount of data is getting generated every minute and every second. Now, here we are already having the data generation. Now, what is the thing is that companies want to analyze this data and they want to get knowledge out of it and they want to use it in their day-to-day life. So that is the challenge over here. So this is one of the reasons that why we are talking about the big data. Earlier, we were not having so much, I would say, social media platforms. Yeah, I still remember that initially we had this social media known as Orkut. Yeah, it worked for some time and then suddenly this Facebook came in and then it got extinct. Yeah, that's Orkut was not available. So, but currently, if you see that we are having huge, I would say, applications which are there for the social media platforms. Yeah. So this is one reason that why we are now talking about big data. The second reason is over here, that is Internet of Things. Now, we all know the short form that is known as IoT. Now, if someone asks me that what is IoT in a very simple language, so I can say that IoT is basically a network of all devices which are connected with each other so that there is easy information exchange. Yeah. So here, say, for example, if I buy a new mobile and if I start the internet connection of my mobile, definitely my mobile is now part of this IoT network. And then I can receive some information, I can send some information. Now let us see that how IoT is contributing to big data. So here we are having this graph and we can see that on the x-axis we are having the year and on the y-axis we are having the billions of devices. Now, if you see over here, my pointer, if you see that in 1992, we were having 1 million devices. Now, this 1 million devices, I'm not talking about India, I'm talking about the whole world. Yeah. So at that time, overall, we were having just 1 million devices. Okay. 1 million devices means it includes your mobile phones and it includes your laptop and whatever desktop and all those things. Yeah. So this was the scenario in 1992. And then you see that there was an exponential growth in these devices, number of devices. Yeah. So currently we are in 2020. And in 2020, we are having approximately around 50 billion devices now. Okay. And on an average, if we see that one person is having around 4 to 5 devices. Okay. So the person will have one laptop, one mobile, then sometimes you have some iPad also and some smartwatch. Yeah. And if you go to the company, in the company, you have your own, say, desktop. So on an average, nowadays, one person is having at least around 4 to 5 devices. Okay. So what happens that when the number of devices increases, when IoT increases, definitely those devices are going to generate data. And it is therefore contributing to this concept known as big data. Okay, big data means we are talking about huge volume of data. Yeah, in simple words, if I can say. So these are the two major reasons that why we are now talking about big data. The first one we saw that it was because of the social media platforms and the e-commerce websites. It is generating a lot of data. And second one is this Internet of Things. Now, before we jump into the definition of big data, let me give you a little bit background about these types of data. Okay, maybe if those of you who are new to this concept. Yeah. So here we have these three types of data. That is structured data, semi-structured data, and unstructured data. Now, structured data, we all know, we have already worked with Excel, then this is database files, CSV files. Yeah. So in structured data, as the name suggests, that we are having some kind of structure. So we are having rows and columns. Yeah. Then we are coming to this unstructured data. Yeah. Before going to the semi-structured data, let us focus on the unstructured data. Now, unstructured means it is totally opposite to the structured data. So here we do not have any kind of structure. So here we are talking about the picture file and audio file, video file. So in all these files, you can see that whenever we get these kind of files, then we have to take those files as it is. Okay, I cannot divide this audio file and then put it into some kind of rows and columns. So we have to take as it is. Nowadays, what is happening that 90% of the data which is getting generated in this today's world, 90% is totally unstructured. Okay. And the rest 10% you can divide between the structured and semi-structured. Yeah. So currently, companies want to do the analysis of this unstructured data. Yeah, they want to see that what people are writing on Twitter, on Facebook, on Instagram, okay, what kind of posts they are creating over there related to their product, related to their company. So they are more inclined towards that thing. Yeah. Now, after this unstructured data, we are having this semi-structured data. So in semi-structured data, let us take an example of an email. Yeah. Now, semi-structured, as the name suggests, that it is here we are having a combination of this structured as well as unstructured data. Yeah. Now, if we talk about email, now in email, what is the structured part? Structured part, that is the part which we are having on the top. So say, for example, if I want to write an email to Hiren sir, then I'll in the two column, I'll write down the email ID of Hiren sir. Then if I want to send the same email to all of you, then I have to use the CC and BCC. Yeah. And then we are having the subject line. So this part, it is known as the structured part. Now, whatever the portion that we are having below, that is known as unstructured part. Yeah. Where our real message is present or available. So here, this email is a combination of both structured as well as unstructured. Yeah, that's why it is known as semi-structured data. So I hope that these three things are clear: structured, semi-structured, and unstructured. Now let us define what is big data. Sorry. So here, this is the definition of big data. But before I read out this whole definition, let us understand this concept of big data with the help of this picture. Now, the title says characteristics of big data. Now, here, one of the, I would say the author, he says that if you want to define big data, you should define the big data based on these three V's. What are those three V's? We are having volume, variety, and velocity. Now, what do you mean by volume? So as the name suggests, big data means we are talking about the volume of data. Okay. So earlier we were talking about the terabytes of data. Okay. Now we are going towards petabytes and zettabytes and yottabytes of data. Okay. I still remember my MBA days where we were having the floppy disk. Okay. Many of you must have also seen the floppy disk. Now, in that floppy disk, what was the capacity of that floppy disk? It was just 1.44 MB. Okay. So I think so in 1.44 MB, even a small Bollywood song cannot be kept in that thing. Yeah. It cannot be saved in that floppy disk. So that was the era. Okay. And now, even if I currently say my son and daughter, they are having their laptop. So that laptop is having the capacity of, say, 250 GB. Still, that is not sufficient for them. Okay. So that is the reason that even 1 terabyte is also not enough. So we are talking now about the huge volume of data over here. Then comes variety. In variety, we are having these three different types of data that we have already just now seen, that is structured data, unstructured data, and the semi-structured data. So variety means we are talking that in big data, you should have all these three different kinds of data. Okay. The third one is known as velocity. So velocity means the rate at which the data is getting generated. Now, earlier, I would say that 20 years back, we were talking about the batch processing of the data. So what do you mean by batch processing of data? That, say, for example, if I'm working as an accountant in a company, now as an accountant, I have to prepare some vouchers. Okay. Because if some person is giving me some money, then I have to give him some voucher. And accordingly, if I give money to that person, then also I have to prepare the voucher. So every day, say, for example, if I prepare 100 vouchers, then what happens that at the end of the day, I have to input those details into my system. And then I can know that, okay, how much money I received and how much money I pay to the different stakeholders. So that was the system. And now currently what we are talking about the real-time data. So those who are working with ERP, they know very well, SAP, that we are talking about the real-time data. And now with the help of this, because of the social media platforms, we are also now talking about the streaming data. Yeah. So these are the three V's which are there to define a big data. Now let us come back to this definition. Now what it says, big data is defined as a term which handles the combination or also single parts of volume, variety, velocity of data. Now before I go further over here, this first line is very, very important. What it says, it handles the combination or also single parts of volume, variety and velocity. Now let me go back to this picture over here. So normally, I've seen that people have a misconception that big data, whenever we are talking about big data, means there has to be huge volume of data. But here, the answer is no. Yeah. Here, if you are having all the three V's, then also the data is known as big data. But even if you are having just one V or two V's, then also the data is known as big data. So sometimes it happens that there is a big organization and that organization is having just volume of data. Okay, they may not have variety and velocity. Then also the data is known as big data. And sometimes if you are working in a small company and that small company may not have large volume of data, but they may have variety of data. Yeah, then also that data is considered as big data. Okay, so that is what is written over here, that it can be either three V's or one V or two V's of data with cost-effective, innovative forms of information processing to enable enhanced insight. Okay, why we are doing this thing? So that we can get some insight, and based on the insight, we can take some decision, and we can also do the process automation. Okay, if we want to automate our manufacturing process, then also big data can help us. So this is I would say one of the definition of big data, where we are talking about these three V's. Yeah. Now, after three V's, okay, definitely people are doing a lot of research in this thing. So one another author came with this concept of seven V's of big data. Now in the seven V's of big data, already he has included those three original V's. So here we are already having volume, velocity and variety. And then he included his own four V's also. Okay, veracity, variability, visualization and value. Now, currently, because so we have already seen the three V's, so I'm not going into detail in the seven V's, but just I wanted to inform you that, okay, this is also we are having the seven V's. And then someone came with 10 V's also. Okay. So maybe next year I'll come up with my own 14 V's of big data. Okay. So it is very easy to define all these 14 V's and 10 V's and likewise. So people are having their own viewpoint. I'm not saying that it is wrong, but what happens that the especially the students who are studying this kind of concept, for them, definitely as the V's and P's increases. Okay. Because I remember my MBA days, in marketing, we were having only four P's of marketing. And now I don't know that how many P's are there. Okay, definitely it must be more than 10. So definitely, so as a student, we have to learn more of these V's and P's. Yeah. Now next concept comes known as big data application area. So where we can apply big data. Now here, because we are having very short time, so I'll not be focusing on all the areas. Yeah. But here I have taken these eight areas. Yeah. So don't think that big data can be applied only on these eight areas. You take any area, and in that area, big data can be applied. So here I have taken like banking and securities, communication, media and entertainment, healthcare, manufacturing and natural resources, okay, insurance, retail, education, transportation. Now let us take some of the examples over here. Now, we'll start with this banking and securities. Now, in banking, one of the major issues which the bank people are facing is the credit card fraud transactions. Okay. We have been using credit card, I think, so more than now 10 or 15 years. Yeah, 15 years or so. And you must have also seen that there are a lot of fraud transactions which are taking place. Okay. Sometimes, like people, they try to steal your PIN number and your credit card number, and then they do the transaction. So here, the bank people are always worried, okay, that how to identify those kind of transactions. So if someone is doing that transaction, then whether that transaction is authentic or not, that they want to do that checking. Now, here in Germany, they have one of the good systems that the bank people are following over here is that normally if I'm doing a transaction, let's say, for example, I'm transferring some amount around, say, between 500 euros and 1000 euros. Now, suddenly, if I do a transaction of, say, 2000 euros, okay, I'm transferring 2000 euros, though it is legal, but still the bank people will see that, okay, normally I'm doing transaction of 500 to 1000 euros. Now, suddenly, why I've gone for the higher amount? So these people will call me on my, say, on my registered mobile number, and then they will ensure that, yes, I'm the only person, I'm the person who is doing this transaction. Yeah. And once they are happy and satisfied, then only they will execute that transaction. Okay. Without their approval, I cannot do the transaction. Yeah. Normal transactions I can do between 500 to 1000, if that is the like normal one. But otherwise, they will always give a call. So in their system, there is some kind of a, I would say, so some kind of a checklist that, okay, if the transaction is going beyond so and so amount, then it will alert them. Yeah. Now, here in credit card fraud transactions, earlier what was happening that these fraud transactions are not new. Yeah? They have been there since since we had this credit card, okay, in this market. Now, earlier what was happening that the bank people were having a lot of customer transactions. Now, if they want to identify that whether their system is perfect or not, so out of that, you can take an example like 1 million transactions. Out of that, they could not carry out the analysis of all the 1 million transactions to check the credit card fraud. Yeah, they had to take a sample of it because there was no software which was available which can do the total analysis of all their transactions. So they had to go for some sample and say, for example, they will go for a sample of, say, 10,000 transactions. Okay, just an example. And then they will do the analysis and then they will come to a conclusion that whether their system is perfect or not. Now, it happens that whenever you are taking a sample from your total population, then it is possible that those credit card fraud transactions which are there. So you assume that there are some 500 frauds which have taken place. Okay, so out of 500, whenever you are taking that sample of 10,000, in the 10,000, you may get hardly 10 transactions, those 10 fraud transactions. And then you do the analysis and then you come to the conclusion that, yes, your system is perfect. But it is possible that those other transactions or other fraud transactions are there in the other data set. Yeah. Now, what is possible that in big data era, we can conduct the analysis of all the customer transactions, whether you are having 1 million or 10 million or 1 billion transactions, you can do the analysis of all the transactions together. And within some few minutes or one day or so, you'll be getting the full analysis and then you'll be able to get the real analysis. Yeah. Earlier, we were having just one kind of an assumption that, okay, we did the analysis of our sample transactions. It was good. So overall, our system should be good. Okay. But now that should be word is not used. Then now you are confirmed that, yes, whether my system is good or not, that you can get the answer immediately. So this is one of the example, I would say, in banking. Now, communication, media and entertainment. Currently in this pandemic era, we have seen lot of movies and lot of series on Netflix and YouTube and whatnot, okay, on Amazon Prime and those things. Now, here I would like to take an example of Netflix. Yeah. Now, I don't know that how many of you have seen this particular series, yeah, House of Cards. So this House of Cards is one of their most popular series. Yeah. And now why this series is so popular? Okay. So now what happened that this House of Cards, this was earlier a UK series. It was very popular in UK. And say they were having a lot of, audiences for this particular series. Then Netflix wanted to recreate this whole series on their own. So what they did that they collected the all the transactions of their audiences for the UK series, and they did the minute detailing. Yeah. So say for example, if you are watching a particular series, then sometimes when you like, sometimes when you like a particular scene, then you try to click on the stop button, yeah, or pause button. Then if you want to see it again, then you go for rewind, yeah, and then again you play the button, yeah, you click on play. So they had taken all these transactions, okay. Sometimes when the scene is boring, then you try to fast forward, yeah. They also came to know that which dialogues were most appreciated by the audience, yeah, for a particular actor, then which dialogues were not appreciated, then which kind of clothing was accepted by the audience for a particular character. So they went into so much detail, and then based on their analysis with the help of big data, they came out with their own House of Cards series. And this House of Cards series has won almost 22 Emmy Awards. These Emmy Awards are very, very popular awards. And from 2013, yeah, this series was launched in 2013. From 2013 till date, they have won 22 Emmy Awards. So this is not a joke. Yeah. So this is how this Netflix is continuously using this kind of big data analysis. Even currently also, if you are watching that Patal Lok, that in Patal Lok also, though you are in Patal Lok, but still this Netflix will do all this analysis. Okay. So they will try to see that which scenes are appreciated by the people, which are not appreciated, okay, where you do rewind and where you do fast forwarding. They note down everything. Yeah. So this is a small example of Netflix. Yeah, and how they are using this big data. Likewise, let us take one example of insurance. Yeah. Now in insurance, we take an example of a car insurance. Yeah. Now, today, if I buy a car and it is of a particular model, and I'm talking about the new car, okay, not the used car, new car. So I will definitely have to pay the car insurance, and based on the model, based on the year, the car insurance company will fix my premium. So every year I have to pay that premium. Now, simultaneously, Hiren sir has also purchased the same car, you can assume. And he has also purchased in this same year. Yeah. So he will be also paying the same premium, which I'll be also paying. Now, what happens that in this 1 year, yeah, normally I'm not driving, in a very good manner, I would say. Okay. I'm driving very rashly, and I have committed one or two accidents on the road. Yeah. So my driving is not so good. But parallelly, Hiren sir's driving is very good. He is very particular about his car, and he drives according to the rules and regulations. Okay. So both of us, they have purchased the same car in the same year, but our driving styles are different. But what happens normally in today's world that though our driving is different, our driving style is different, but still we are paying the same premium currently. But now what is going to come in near future that your car will have a particular device, a chip, and that chip will send the data to the your car insurance company. Okay, so whenever you are registering, whenever you are registering with a car insurance company, they will say that you either you have to have this chip, or if the chip is already there, then you have to get connected, or you have to connect the chip to the car insurance company. Yeah, and then they will collect all this data. Okay, so what happens that in the first year, me and Hiren sir, we are paying the same premium, but next year, definitely I have to pay more premium because I am more risky for the insurance company. Okay, while Hiren sir, because he is driving very good, so he will be paying a lesser premium. Yeah, so company is giving some kind of a discount to Hiren sir based on his good driving skills, I would say. Yeah. So this is how it is going to happen, yeah, in insurance. Maybe some of you must be just now maybe a little bit laughing that, oh, this is not possible, but this is going to be possible. Okay, already in some of the countries they have already tested this thing. Even for our life insurance also, they will be doing the same thing. If you are eating a lot of junk food and if you are not taking care of your health, yeah, then definitely you are going to pay higher premium, yeah, compared to your other friends or colleagues. So likewise, I can go on and on over here, but let us go further. There are, as I said earlier, that there are a lot of applications in each and every area you talk about it. There are big data applications. Now the third part, that is known as types of roles. So we will be focusing. So I'll be focusing on the job roles. So here, there are three different types of roles which are there in this big data area. So first of all, we'll be talking about the data analyst. Then we'll be talking about the big data engineer. And then we'll be talking about the position known as data scientist. Now, who are data analysts? So they are experienced data professionals in their organization who can query and process data, provide reports, summarize and visualize data. So what is it that a person, you can see over here that this person, that is the data analyst, he or she tries to collect the data, do a little bit of processing of the data, cleaning the data, and then his or her major role is to prepare these kind of visualizations and try to get information out of it. Okay, try to summarize and visualize the data. The tools which are normally used by the data analyst are MS Excel, SQL, SPSS, SAS, MS Access, Power BI, Tableau. Now, definitely, you must have heard all these tools. Yeah, MS Excel is very, very basic one, but still it is very powerful, I would say. Then SQL, Structured Query Language. We all know how to say whenever we want to communicate with the database, then definitely we should know SQL. SPSS, as just now, we also as I mentioned that he's regularly conducting sessions on SPSS. So SPSS is a statistical tool. SAS is also a statistical tool. But what I found out, to be frank with you, that SPSS is more, I would say, famous in India compared to the other countries. Yeah, and SAS is famous outside India, I would say. Then we have MS Access, which is again a database. And then we are having this Power BI Tableau. So Power BI Tableau, those of you who already know it, that they are known as data visualization tools. So today in our this particular presentation, I'll be also talking a little bit about Tableau. Yeah. So this is the job role of a data analyst. So if someone asks me that, sir, how can I start my career in this big data area? So my strong recommendation will be to go for this data analyst position. Okay. Now remember that for becoming data analyst, it is not compulsory to start your career with the programming. Okay, that you should know programming very well. Even if your MS Excel skills or SQL, MS Excel, SQL, and if you know one of the tools like Power BI or Tableau, then also it is great. Okay, so you can start your career by having the knowledge of these two or three tools. Yeah, and then if you are really interested in this big data area, then definitely you have to learn programming, because if you want to go further, if you want to go in the machine learning or deep learning, then definitely. Hello.
I request participant to mute their microphone so that it won't disturb.
Yeah. Okay. So here, that is what I was saying, that if you want to go further in this area, then definitely the knowledge of R programming, Python, that is really required. Okay. But initially with this knowledge, you can definitely start your career. Okay. And it is not compulsory that you should have this designation of data analyst. I have seen some many of my students who are currently having experience of 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, yeah, say in the marketing or finance or production, yeah, or HR. Now, those people, if they are having these kind of skills, yeah, along with that, then definitely it will help them also. Okay, so you can just have the designation like marketing manager or product manager or finance manager. So with that designation also, if you learn this new technology, then definitely it will help you further. Yeah. Then the next one is known as data engineer. So data engineer, mostly they are working more with the data. They're like preparing the data, preparing this infrastructure. And if you remember that earlier we were having this position known as database administrators, DBAs. So you can consider that these DBAs are, or these data engineers are similar to DBAs. Yeah. But nowadays, I would say the role of data engineers is much more important, because these people, they do those background the backend work, I would say. Yeah. So because directly, if you have the data, then you cannot directly go for the data visualization and data analysis. The important thing is that you have to do a lot of data cleaning and data transformation. Yeah. In computer, we have one particular terminology that is known as GIGO. So garbage in, garbage out. So if you input your garbage into the system, yeah, if your data is a garbage, then definitely your analysis will be also a garbage. Yeah. So before you go for the analysis, you have to do a lot of data cleaning and data transformation. And it is said that the people who are in this area, they always say that their role is like a janitor. It is known as a data janitor. Janitor means those people who are cleaning the toilet. Yeah. So I'm not saying that you have to clean the toilet, but whenever you are working with the data, it is said that 80% to 85% of your time goes in the data cleaning and data transformation. Because what happens that whenever you are working in a company, the data is already there, but it is lying in different parts of the company. Then you have to get the data at one place. Those data are not in a proper format or same format, so you have to make it in same format. So there is a lot of work over here. Yeah. So just if you see some fancy charts and those things, don't think that it is very easy. Yeah. It is a lot of hard work over there. Yeah. From all these people. So these are the data engineers. Then the tools which are used by these data engineers are Hadoop, SQL, NoSQL, HiveP programming, etc. Okay. There are many different tools which are there. So these are data engineers. Now the third position, definitely you must have heard this position very well, that is known as data scientist. So who are data scientists? Someone who can turn raw data into purified insights. Okay. So these people, in my term, I can say that they are like an all-rounder, because these people, they know, or say they should know everything, I would say. So let us see that what they should know. They should know statistics, machine learning, analytical approaches to solve critical business problems. Okay. So these people should have both the business knowledge as well as the IT knowledge or the big data knowledge. And the tools which are used by the data scientists are normally Python, R, Scala, Apache Spark, Hadoop, machine learning, deep learning, and statistics. And as these people are all-rounder, that's why they are paid a very heavy salary, I would say, very high salary. Okay, they are paid the highest salary compared to the data analyst and data engineer. But again, one important thing that whenever you are searching for the jobs for these three positions, then definitely the data analyst positions are more. Okay, the job positions are more for the data analyst. Then we are having for data engineer, and then we are having very say few positions for data scientist. So don't think that there is no opportunity in data as a data scientist. But what happens that normally the only the big companies, or you can say medium companies, they are able to afford a data scientist because of that high salary. But otherwise, the people who are working as a data analyst, they can work even in the small organizations also. Okay. So these are the three different positions. Now we come to the come to the nearer of our presentation. So Indian analytics market, what is the scenario in India? So overall here it says that analytics market in India is currently valued at around $3 billion. The market is growing at 26%. Then it is employing more than 120,000 people. Now 600 companies are there approximately, or it can be more also, out of which 400 are startups. Now this is very, very important for all of you who are say trying to have their own company. Okay, even for the students also, this is very lucrative. So it is very easy to start your big data startup, I would say. Okay. So normally what you require, you can work from home also currently, yeah, and even later on also you can work from home, and you require just a laptop and your internet connections, yeah, and plus nowadays what the tools which are available for the data analysis, most of the tools are open source tools, so they are freely available, or sometimes the tools, the cost is also comparatively less. Okay, so there is, so here in this big data startup, you not have to invest so much money, yeah, and you can start with your own, and then once you get more and more work from the company, then definitely you can employ more people over here. The sectors which are getting benefited over here, that these are some of the factors, okay, sectors. So I have not written all the sectors, but don't think that these are the only sectors which are getting affected because of big data. No, there are many more sectors over here. The future of data analytics in India. So currently India is among the top 10 big data analytics market in the world, and the target is to become among the top three in the next 3 years. The analytics market is expected to double by 2025. This is also very good. And India will have 32% market share. Currently it is 26%. It will go to 32%. And still you can say that there will be increased demand in all these sectors. Yeah, so every year, I would say that now every day, a lot of researches are taking place related to the big data in different areas. Now, those who want to go for the startup, then here I have put some list of all those famous startups which are there in big data. Yeah, these are some of the startups. So I would not say this is the full list. So these are some of the famous big data startups. So all these companies, they started with just 1%, 2% or 3%. And then they move forward, yeah, and they are now big organizations. Now the fifth topic, that is European analytics market. So here you can see that this chart shows you the big data market size revenue forecast for the whole world. This is not currently just for the Europe, it is for the whole world. So you can see that it is showing you from 2011 to 2027. Currently we are in 2020, and the market is around $56 billion. And you will see that in the next 7 years, the market will double. So this is again showing you the huge opportunity over here in this big data area. Then let me skip this thing. Yeah. Now here we are talking about the European data market. So in European data market, it is showing you the comparison between 2016 and current year 2020. So here we are able to see that there is a huge increase in the number of data workers. This I would say from the point of view of the jobs. Then this many number of companies are now there. in Europe I'm talking about, yeah, and this is the data economy value. So in 2016 it was approximately around 300 billion euros, and now it is approximately around 740. So within just 4 years it is more than double. Yeah, then this chart shows the what are the average salaries per level of education for these seven European countries. So we have countries like Italy, Spain, France, Netherlands, UK, Switzerland, and Germany. And here we are having these three levels of education. So we have bachelor's, master's, and doctorate. Yeah. Now, overall, here you can see that Switzerland is giving the highest salary for all these three levels. Yeah. But as you know, that those who have visited Switzerland as a tourist, you know that Switzerland is very costly. The overall cost of living is very high. So don't think that Switzerland is giving great salary, so we should go towards Switzerland only, okay? We have to also see the average cost of living. And here in Italy, though, I studied in Italy, so I know very well that here you are able to see a less salary in Italy, but overall the cost of living is also less, yeah? So, and this is Germany, yeah? So Germany, you can say that it is in between these countries like Italy, Spain, and this countries like Switzerland and UK. Yeah, so it is in between. This is the overall analytics opportunities in Germany, and here you can see that these big dots, which you are able to see, this first dot on the eastern side, this is the capital city, Berlin. So definitely Berlin here, it is more famous for the startups. Yeah. So majority of the startups which are there in Germany, they are all established in Germany, in Berlin. Yeah. Then here, this dot is of Hamburg. Yeah. Then somewhere here, we are having cities like Dusseldorf and Cologne. This is Frankfurt. And then here, this again, a major dot in the southern part, this is Munich. Yeah, so all the major cities of Germany, they are having a lot of opportunities related to big data. Yeah, so up till now, I had given you a brief background about what is big data, what are the application areas, and then we saw the analytics market also, both for India as well as Europe. And then now we are focusing on this last topic for today, that is introduction to Tableau. Yeah. Now, I'm very sure that some of you must have heard about this Tableau software. Now, those of you who are totally new to this Tableau, then also you don't worry. Let me give you a brief background. So, what is Tableau? Okay. So, Tableau, it was co-founded in 2003. By these three people, that is Chris Stolte, Pat Hanranan, yeah, and Christian Chabot. Yeah. Then it is the one of the famous, I would say, data visualization tool. Yeah. Currently, it is holding second position in analytics and BI market. So I'll now show you later on that the overall chart of this analytics in BI market. It is much more user friendly than MS Excel. Okay, today I'll give you an example also over here. And Tableau is having different versions. So one of their version, which is known as Tableau Public, that is totally free of cost. Okay, so you have to just download the Tableau Public, and then you can start working on it if you want to have a grip on it. Yeah. Now this is that I would say the famous quadrant for the analytics and BI platform, business intelligence platform. And this, say every year, this company Gartner, now again, this Gartner company has come up over here. Yeah. Now Gartner is a very, very famous research company. And every year they are coming out with these kind of different quadrants. Now here you can see that in this leaders quadrant, there are these two tools which are available. The first one is from Microsoft and second one is this Tableau. Now, Microsoft currently here, if you are able to see this, Microsoft means we are talking about the tool known as Power BI now. Yeah. So overall, Power BI is number one and Tableau is number two. But you can see that there is not that much difference between these two tools. Okay, so don't think that Power BI is great and Tableau is not so great. No, it is not like that. Both the tools are having equal importance. And now it is dependent upon the company that whether they are going for Power BI or Tableau. And I would say that you should have knowledge of both the tools. If you want to really go in this area, try to have at least knowledge of both the tools. Yeah. Even if you are, even for the students also, I'm recommending that at least you have the basic knowledge. And if you write down in your CV that I'm also knowing Tableau and Microsoft, this Power BI, then really it makes importance for you. Okay. You will get highlighted out of those different CVs which are there. Yeah. So currently, if you write down knowledge of MS Office, I think so people will laugh at you, to be frank with you. Okay. MS Office, when we were doing our MBA in 2000, at that time, writing MS Office was great. Okay. But I'm not saying that MS Office, knowledge of MS Office is not good. Especially in MS Office, if you know Excel very well, yeah, there are still companies in India who are working on Excel only. So at least you should have a very good knowledge of Excel. Yeah, and then if that is supported with these two visualization tools like Power BI and Tableau, then definitely you can have a very bright future over here. Now, coming to my experiences and my training program. So when I was working in this company, Continental, so there I first of all came in contact with this tool known as Power BI. And as I was taking care of this training and community, so in Continental, I almost conducted 34 workshops, yeah, in just 7 months. And totally, I trained around 1,750, yeah. And I also conducted both the classroom sessions as well as the webinars, yeah. So currently, when we were having this say lockdown in India, so for me, webinar was not that much, say something different. Yeah. So I was already conducting these kind of webinars regularly. And as sir has given this my introduction, so I'm having this Power BI certification. I cleared this exam that is known as analyzing and visualizing data with Power BI. Then this is my Tableau certification. This is the first exam of Tableau. I'm also now preparing for my second exam in Tableau. So this exam is known as Tableau Desktop Specialist. Then in Power BI, I have conducted up till now, I think so, 5 workshops. So first workshop I conducted with the Ganpat University in May and June. Then I conducted the second workshop with this Adi Shankara Business School, which is in Kerala. So one of my ex-colleague, she's there as a principal. So she invited me for this workshop, and both this workshop, the major participants were students. Yeah, total there were around 250 plus participants in both these workshops, and out of this, I can say that around 200 were just students. Yeah, so even for students also, this is very, very important. Then I conducted session in Lakshmi Institute. Again, it is normally a 5-day workshop. Same way with this institute in Pune, Skillsled. Yeah. And then recently, I conducted again the workshop of Power BI with this Anand Education Foundation. Yeah, and it got completed only on this 18th of October. Yeah. So this is all about my experiences in Power BI. Now Tableau. So I was fortunate enough to get an invitation from this engineering institute in Tamil Nadu, that is IFET College of Engineering. And there, they had given me specific topics. So I had to take session on these advanced charts in Tableau and dashboard and stories. So they conducted this kind of, it was known as STTP, AICT sponsored STTP, and they conducted 3 rounds of STTP. So in all the rounds, I had taken these topics, the same topics. So this was the first round, then this was the second round. It was in August. And then in the September, they had the third slot. And in the third slot, they also gave me another one topic that is known as expressions in Tableau. Yeah. So I'm also having this experience of both like Power BI and Tableau. And now, this is what I think so now me and Hiren sir, we are going to announce our upcoming workshop on Tableau. So Hiren sir, would you like to now take over?
Let me share my screen.
Yeah.
So is my screen visible, sir?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So since sir has given the introduction very beautifully, connected all the real life example with the big data and how this data visualization is important. So in 1 hour or one and a half hour, it is difficult to learn something. It is just to give you the insight that why it is important to learn. So to have that idea in mind, we plan this workshop of 5 days that is online. So basically, how this will work. So the content is also given. I'll also share the link in the description. Yes, this link is there. So let me paste that link in the chat box. So you may visit that link later on after this workshop. But the regular price for this 5 days online certification course is $1,499 in a usual setup. But due to this COVID, we are giving the discount up to 50%. So it is $7,499. As we mentioned in our message that we are going to give a special discount to the participant who will attend this webinar. So additional 13% of discount we are giving away. So that is $649. So if anyone who is registering by today, by this 12 a.m. In the night. So the price will be $649 and after that it will be $749. So this is what we announced about this Tableau. So if anyone is interested to learn this Tableau in detail, so we are going to start with the scratch. As sir has mentioned that we will consider that you are very novice to the Tableau technology. So we'll start with how to download and install this Tableau, and then whatever data that you are having in Excel or CSV or text, how you can take it to the Tableau, and then you can convert those data into some meaningful charts and patterns and everything. So that is what we wanted to announce. And sir, now you would like to show something in the Tableau and Excel?
Yes, sir.
So you can continue.
So let me share my screen now. Okay, so this is here we had winded up our presentation. Now first of all, before I go and try to show you a demo of it, so here this is our workshop date. So we are starting from 30th of October till 3rd of November, and the timing we are keeping it very convenient. So it will be in the evening, Indian Standard Time only. Yes, definitely. So 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. every day for these 5 days continuously. Okay, and here we have put down the in general the content. Okay, definitely you will be seeing the detailed content on the website of Start Modeler. So say once you register, then definitely you will be able to see this thing. So here we are having day one, as sir mentioned, that introduction to Tableau and connecting data. Then on the second day we'll be starting we'll be focusing on how to create the various charts. Then day three we'll be talking more about the how to do the sorting, grouping, how to use these marks cards. Though currently, if everything is totally new to you, don't worry, I'll be explaining you in detail over here. Then day four we'll be talking about hierarchies and filters. And then day five, we'll be talking about the dashboard and stories. Yeah. Now, let me show you one small demo. Yeah. So here you can see my screen that I'm having a data set, which is there in Excel. And it is a very famous data set that is known as Sample Superstore. Yeah. Now, when you download Tableau, then this sample superstore data, this is by default given by Tableau so that you can do a lot of practice over there. Yeah, but definitely we'll be also sharing with all of you during the workshop. And plus we'll be also telling you how to download the software and then how to install and all those things, and then how to access the data set. Yeah, So it will be totally a hands-on practical session. First of all, let me tell you one thing. Okay, so it will totally be hands-on practical. So as soon as I'll be clicking on some button, then you will be also clicking simultaneously with me. So you will be learning with me. Okay, and when if you are having any kind of query, definitely you can ask me and your query will be resolved immediately. So here we are having this sample superstore. Now I would like to show you that how Excel is different from Tableau, yeah, and how Tableau is much more user friendly. Now this data set which you are able to see, this is a very large data set. So it is having almost, if we go down, then it is having approximately around 9,994 say records which are there. Now what kind of thing we are having? So this particular data set is about a superstore. So you can say, assume that like what we are having is Amazon. So there is one superstore, yeah, online superstore, and they are having a lot of those customer transactions. So whenever a customer buys a product, then his or her transaction comes over here. So here we are having the columns like row ID, order ID, order date, ship mode, customer ID, customer name, yeah, segment, country of region, city, state. Mostly here you will see that the data is from US, yeah, postal code, region, product ID, category, subcategory, product name. And then finally, we are having these numbers like sales, quantity, discount, and profit. Now, here we are talking about this category. So we have category and subcategory, and then we also have the product name. Now, what I would like to do that I would like to know the sales of each and every category over here. Yeah. So I would like to see that, okay, how much sales is available in furniture category or office supplies or the third category. Yeah. So here in Excel, yeah. And here, so before I show you that thing, below, if you see that here we are having these three sheets. So first of all, this is known as order sheet. Then we have this people sheet, yeah, and then we have the return sheet. Okay, so just now we'll be focusing only on this order sheet. Now here, I would like to have the category wise sales. Okay, that is my target. Now, if you want to have the category by sales, then here in Excel, we have to use the concept known as power pivot. Yeah. So to do the power pivot, we have to click on this insert. Yeah. Most of you must be knowing very well. So pivot table. So we click on this pivot table. Then here it is asking us the range. So here it has taken the full range. Yeah. From this first say value till the last value. And here it says that choose where you want the pivot table report to be placed. So I'm selecting new worksheet, yeah, and then I click OK. So now here, this is my blank pivot table, yeah. And now here I have to put some, here we are having these four areas. Sorry, I think so I'm hearing some voice in the background. Okay, thank you. So here we have to put in the something in the filters and columns and values and or rows. Yeah. Now, what I would like to do that I would like to have the category by sales over here. So here we are having first of all the sales. So sales, I will drag it to these values. Yeah. So now here it is showing us that it is summing up all the sales. And then we are having this category. So if I double click on this category, yeah, or I can tick mark, sorry, I tick mark it. And then here category is coming in the rows area. And here in this pivot table, let me make it a little bit bigger. Yeah. So here we are able to see the different category wise sales. Okay, with the help of this pivot table. So in Excel, definitely we have to create first of all this pivot table. And now I can create the chart over here. So if I click on this pivot chart, then it is suggesting me this chart, that is clustered column chart. So I click on it and okay. Yeah. So this is my clustered column chart for this thing. Yeah. So this is a very simple chart. Now let us do the same thing in Tableau. Yeah. So that you will be able to see the difference. So this is my Tableau workspace. And here on the left hand side, it says that connect. Yeah. So here, first of all, we have to connect the data set. So what I do that I click on this Excel, because our file is an Excel file. So I click on Microsoft Excel. And then let me go to that table. Yeah, I select this sample superstore. I click open. Yeah. So now on the left hand side, you can see that there are these three sheets which are there in this particular table, that is sample superstore. Okay, so you focus on these three. So we have orders, people, and returns. Now, if we want to work only in orders, yeah, with the order sheet, then we have to drag this order sheet over here, yeah, in this area. And as soon as you drag it over here, then below you can see the whole data set. Okay, here we are having all those same titles, that is row ID, order ID, order date, ship mode, etc. Now, once this data set is over here, then below it is showing you sheet one. So if you click on sheet one, now here you can start creating the visualization directly. And whatever those rows which were there, you were able to see the different columns, those things have come up over here. Now in the workshop, definitely I'll be talking about that, why some of the fields are over here on the top and what are these other fields, yeah, and how it is categorized in these two different categories. Now what we want to do, we want to create a chart showing the category wise sales. So what I can do, I can select this category, yeah, I can select this sales also. Now here we are having this list of basic charts which are over here. So as soon as I select both these things, that is category and sales, here it is showing us some of the suggestions. So I can create the pie chart, I can create this bar chart and this column charts, yeah, stake column charts, and even this tree map also, even this bubble chart also. So it is giving us suggestions. Yeah. Now let us create this our normal bar chart. So I click on it. Now here, if we see this bar chart, yeah, this is our column chart. And here we have created the bar chart. Now, if I want to just convert this bar chart into column chart, then here we have this button. If we click on it, now it is our column chart. Okay. Then if I want to expand this thing, yeah, then I can make it, just hold on, I can make it like this also, so that it becomes bigger. Yeah. So likewise, what I wanted to show you over here, that it is very easy to create visualizations in tools like Tableau. Yeah. And here I was talking about this marks card. If you see that one of the content in our workshop is talking about the marks card. So how to use this marks card, how to use this color, size, label, detail, tooltip, etc. Okay. So likewise, we'll be covering this concept when I'll be starting, as Sir said, that I'll be starting from the scratch. Yeah. With what is Tableau and how to say connect this data sources, different data sources. Even the focus will be more on the data cleaning also, because as I said that 80 to 90% of the time of the data analyst goes in the data cleaning and data transformation. So we'll be doing a good amount of data cleaning and data transformation, and then we'll be starting with this different visualizations. And in the visualizations, we'll be seeing the concept like sorting and say hierarchy and grouping, and how to create the sets, yeah, And then finally, once we create these different kind of sheets, different kind of visualizations, then we have to create a dashboard. And normally in the dashboard, we try to place at least 3 to 4 different visualizations. And then on the last day, we also have a concept known as stories. So normally, when if you have created some kind of visualizations, if you have created some dashboard, now you want to show that dashboard to your colleagues, to your superiors. So then, instead of, I would say that copying the this visualization and putting in the PowerPoint, here in this Tableau, we also have the concept known as stories. So I was talking about this thing. So this is just I've given you a brief overview of how we'll be working with the Tableau, and it is very easy. And definitely will be this 5 days workshop will be fun. And whatever the best thing I can share with you, I'll definitely share with you. And I want that initially, see, normally what happens that whenever you are working with a new tool, then there is sometimes a lot of anxiety or sometimes there is also fear to use that tool. But once you go through this whole workshop, then definitely my job is to remove that anxiety, remove that fear, and then you can be very comfortable with this thing. Yeah. So just now, maybe some of the concept may be totally going out of your mind, but don't worry, I'll be going step by step in this this 5 days workshop. And immediately whenever you are having any kind of errors or any kind of issues, then definitely I'll be telling you that how to remove those errors. So that's all from my side, Hiren sir.
Yes, thank you so much, sir, for giving a wonderful presentation. Now I would like to request all the participants to, if you are having any query, you can unmute your microphone and then ask your query one by one, or you can raise your hand and then I'll speak the name of the person and then you can unmute and ask the question, or you can also put your question in the chat box. I have already shared one link of to download this material. So I'm again pasting that link in the chat box, so you can download this material from that. If you have any query, then please ask in the chat box. We would like to answer the query. So once this question and answer session is over, I'll share the link to claim your certificate.
So if anybody is having any questions related to our today's presentation, or maybe question related to our this workshop also, then definitely you can ask me now, or we can also get connected later on. So I hope that you will join this workshop and
I'm again sharing a link to with the special discount. So this link will be valid till tonight at 12 a.m. So whoever is interested, please register through that. And now,
so we are having some question.
Yes, one question is there, sir. How useful will be the certificate of this workshop in the field of data visualization? So, sir, can you would you like to add something to this?
I'll tell you first of all that when you have this a certificate for this workshop, definitely you cannot claim that I want to have a job for that thing. But what I'm saying that whenever you are attending this workshop and you are enriching your knowledge, and if you also show to your company, maybe if you are working in a company or if you are a student, and if you show it to your colleagues or to your superiors that yes, I have attended this thing, I know so and so thing. And just attending the workshop is not important. You have to also later on do a lot of practice. So after this workshop is over, I'll be also sharing some of the good say material where you can work on it and you can enrich your knowledge over there. Yeah, so please don't take that, okay, I'll have the certificate and then immediately I'll apply for the job. No, it is not possible. Even if you are attending the courses on Udemy or Coursera, that will not give you a job. Yeah, but the important thing is that what kind of, how much knowledge you are having for that particular tool. Yeah, that is important. So
very correct, sir.
The certificate, don't give importance to the certificate. You give importance to the knowledge that you will be gaining in this workshop. Yeah, and definitely we'll be in touch with each other. So later on, if you, especially for students, because I'm coming from the education background, so I have handled almost more than 1,000 students in my 15 years career. So I also know that what kind of queries are there for the students, and say how to show their skills in the resume. And maybe if someone wants to come over here in Germany, they are most welcome over here. Yeah. So how to apply over here with this required knowledge. Yeah. So there are a lot of things which are which we can discuss. So maybe we'll be discussing more in detail during our that 5 days workshop, because I know that there are a lot of questions. So try to utilize this 5 days, or I would say total 10 hours. It is of 10 hours duration total. So try to utilize it. Yeah.
Yes, sir. There is another query that how is Tableau different than Power Query and Power Pivot? Just as easy, or are there any other benefits too?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, see, me and Hiren sir, we have regularly conducted this Power BI. So, first of all, let me also talk about this thing, and maybe Hiren sir can add on it. So, see, this Power Query, Power Pivot, earlier, like this were like an add-on. Yeah. So, this were add-ons which were provided in Excel. So in normal Excel, you will not find this thing, but now it is coming in as an add-on. So you can, if you want to do the data cleaning and those things, then definitely you have to use the Power Query Editor. It is also known as Power Query Editor. And if you want to customize or say, if you want to compress your data and if you want to do some kind of totaling, then you use this kind of Power Pivot. Yeah. Now what has happened that in this Microsoft, what they did that initially, as I said, that with Microsoft Excel you were having these kind of add-on. Now since 2014 they have come up with this tool known as Power BI, and in Power BI you are having everything. Okay, so you don't have a separate tool known as Power Pivot or like that, but Power BI can also do all those compiling. And Power BI, it is including one part known as Power Query Editor. So up till now, like normally in my Power BI workshop, I say 2 days I give focus only on the how to use the Power Query Editor, how to do the data cleaning, data transformation. So if you are well versed, if you know this Power Query or Power Pivot, then definitely this fundamental will help you in learning these new tools also, that is Power BI or Tableau. Yeah. And to be frank with you, see, Tableau and Power BI, they are two separate softwares. Yeah. But overall, if you see their fundamentals are same. Yeah. Their foundation is same. So if you have learned one tool, say for example, Power BI, and then if you want to switch over to Tableau, that switchover is very easy, I would say. Or reverse also it is there. Yeah. If you've learned Tableau and then if you want to learn Power BI, then also it is comparatively easy. Yeah. Here just the look and feel of both the softwares are different. Otherwise the concept of data visualization, it is same. And all those concepts are coming from that tool known as MS Excel. So if you are so good in MS Excel, that will help you over here also in learning these two tools. Yeah.
Yes. Is there any other query?
Hello, sir. My name is Dara. Actually, I have some problem with the keypad writing, so that's why I have to unmute and ask the question. So I am one of the ex-students of Samir, sir. So it's really very, great experience to hear you back from after so many years. So my question is, currently I am working as a data analyst. And as you have shown that you have certified for Microsoft Power BI and the Tableau and everything. So yeah. I just wanted to know that currently I have a basic knowledge of the machine learning like R, Python.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, have we lost our voice?
Yeah. I think we
okay.
lost.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Maybe in between we can have another person who can who want to ask questions. Then we can have.
Yeah. One question is there, like, what are the prerequisites for the upcoming Tableau seminar? So there is no actually prerequisite. So the willingness to learn this, that is the prerequisite, because we are going to start from the scratch. So there is no prerequisite that you should know this and then only you can attend. It is not like that. You can attend learning.
Yeah, true. And actually, from the point of view of the hardware requirement, if I focus on that thing, then definitely you should have a laptop, a normal configuration laptop which we are having currently. That is also enough. And see, now whenever you will be attending this workshop, I would recommend that you should have two screens. Okay, one screen where you will be seeing me doing the activity, and on the other screen you will be working on it. Yeah, you will be working on your own. But sometimes if you are not having any two screens, then definitely you can see my session on your mobile, and then you can work simultaneously on your laptop or desktop. Okay, that is also possible. So many of my students, they have done this thing also, or the participant. But to the ideal situation will be to have two screens. Yeah. But even if no screens are there, or two screens are there, you can work with mobile plus the combination of laptop or desktop. Now, Tableau is the next level of Excel. Both even Tableau and Power BI, you can say that they are next level of Excel. So now Excel, see, there are a lot of advantages of Excel, but overall now, there are also disadvantages of Excel also. Now, let me share one thing, that a small thing, that say, for example, you have created some visualization. Okay, you have created some visualization and you have shared that visualization with your boss. Okay, now you are updating that visualization every week because you are getting more and more data every week. So you are updating your visualization. Now, normally in Excel, what happens that every time you have to send that link, Excel link to your, to your boss, and your boss will try to see those things. Okay. But in case of Tableau, say, for example, Tableau is having a very good feature that you can link that Tableau, worksheet with your boss. And then and you have to set up that every Friday evening at 5 o'clock, the updated there'll be a message between which will be going to your boss email ID, and he or she will be able to know that okay, I've got some updated view. Yeah, so you can do these kind of the preparation. Yeah, so once you have set up this thing, then every time you don't have to send the link to your boss. Yeah, this is one of the best feature of Tableau. So what these different companies, what they have seen, that especially this Tableau and Power BI, that they have seen what are the limitations of Excel, and then they have worked on it. In Power BI, I've seen that most of the functions which you are using in Excel, the same functions you can also use in Power BI and also in Tableau. So if your fundamentals of Excel are very good, definitely that will help you. But I'm not saying that the knowledge of Excel is the prerequisite for this workshop. Even if you are not good in Excel, still you can learn this Tableau very well. Yeah. Which one is best or high demanding in the world, Power BI or Tableau? I would say that both are parallel. Yeah, both are having the same importance. Yeah. Overall, when we see the terms of ranking, then definitely Power BI is coming first. But immediately second is known as Tableau. Yeah. And again, it depends upon the company where you are going or where you are applying for the job, okay, or where you are working. So it depends. Like some companies, they go for Power BI, some companies, they go for Tableau. Yeah, even when I was working in Continental, we were having four different types of visualization tools: Power BI, Tableau. Then we were having MicroStrategy, and another tool was known as ClickSense. Yeah. So then we came up to one particular tool because we wanted to save money. So that's why we went for overall Power BI. But I'm not here. I'm not saying that Power BI is better than Tableau. Yeah. Both are equally famous, I would say.
So, sir, just to cut short my question.
Yeah. Sorry, we could not hear you continuously because there was some in between break. So what was your question?
So the webinar would be helping in terms of if I wanted to have a certification further. I mean, what kind of things would be there during the certification exam? Would it be, I mean, the things are will be covered into the webinar, I mean the workshop which we are talking about?
Yes, I think so. For Tableau, I would say that because I've given both the examinations, Tableau and Power BI, and if you ask me personally, then I found out Tableau examination much more difficult compared to Power BI. Because in Tableau, there is a mix of both the theoretical question as well as the practical part. So in Tableau examination, you have to also carry out the practical part, try to create the visualization, and then whatever they have asked the question, you have to identify the answer out of that four. Okay, so it is, so though everything is multiple choice, but still you have to do the visualization practically, and then you can answer that question. In case of Power BI, everything is multiple choice. So I would say that when you are attending my Power BI workshop, then definitely it is sufficient for you to go for the examination. For Tableau, because Tableau, the initial certification which I cleared, that is the Tableau desktop specialist, everything I cannot cover within these 10 hours, yeah, to be frank with you, because if this is an introductory session, introductory workshop, and then later on we are planning to go for the intermediate. I feel that if you attend both these workshops, that is introductory as well as intermediate, then in these two workshops, definitely you will be able to cover everything which is there in that, which is required for the certification. And later on, if you are really interested in the certification, then I can also give you personal recommendation that how to clear this kind of certification. Yeah. So that is what. But just with this one workshop in Tableau, you cannot go for the certification. You require more practice for it. Yeah, and more topics has to be covered.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah, sorry. Good evening. Yeah, good evening, Rohit, sir. Rohit, sir, na? Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah,
yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I am working on Jira, and obviously, sir, I am basically focusing on project management. And now you have said that in Tableau that we can send a schedule progress report. So my small question was that can we use Tableau in projects, or you can say implementing the projects, and like we can send the like the team shares should be there. The progress can be like, as you have said, it is showing beautiful graphs and visualization. So can we make some story on it, and can we share it to our project management, and especially it can be for a specific project. Can we use it like that way? Is it possible?
Yes, if you are also using this visualization, for your project management, and then if you want to share your visualization with your colleagues or with your superiors, then definitely you can go for the Tableau. That is possible. Yeah. But if you are not doing anything and if you are just focusing on your project management work only, then I would not recommend to use the Tableau.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, sir.
There is one question in the chat box, sir, from is Power BI and Tableau are only visualization, or it is analytics built in where we can get some insights?
Okay, so both Power BI and Tableau, mostly they are working very well with the structured data, yeah. But both the tools, they are also now say very good for the advanced analytics, I would say, yeah. So and currently they are having a lot of research which are going on in this, how to analyze the unstructured data. But say both these tools are currently, I'm using the word currently, they are having a little bit of limitation, yeah. But for the structured data, they are the best one, yeah. And more and more features are now coming every 2-3 months. Some of the new features are coming. Even say when you connect with Power BI, then, and if you register for the newsletter, so every month they are coming out with some kind of updates. Yeah. So all these, both these tools, these famous tools, they are having a lot of updation, and now they are more focused on how to do the machine learning or deep learning with the help of these tools, yeah, and how to do the overall advanced analytics. So currently they are having some of the features of advanced analytics, but not all, yeah. If you want to do if you want to do hardcore machine learning and deep learning, then you should learn this R and Python, yeah. In that you can do wonders over there. But and normally people, they also use a combination of both R programming and Power BI, or Python and Power BI. And in Power BI and Tableau, they are having both these tools. Yeah. So if you are doing any kind of data analysis, if you're doing any kind of data modeling, if you're creating some model in Python or R, then if you want to visualize those things, then definitely you connect to either Tableau or Power BI. Yeah. So that is possible.
Yes, is there any other question? I have already shared the link to claim your certificate. So I hope everyone has filled that link.
Yeah.
So certificate, only those people will get the certificate who fill that link, because it is difficult to, you know, monitor this much of crowd. So that's why we have created that link. So if anyone is left, please fill that form and you will get your certificate immediately. Now, somebody is asking, can we connect from the Python to Tableau?
Yeah, it is possible. It is possible. So maybe in the workshop, I'll try to show you that thing. If we are having some kind of a particular use case, and if you want to show it, then definitely we can also see that how we can connect with this Python and R with Tableau. Yeah. So that we can show it in the workshop. Yeah.
So I have again shared the link, because somebody is asking for the link. So I have shared the link. You can feel that.
So I request all of you, that those who have attended this workshop, then please try to make it possible. This webinar. Then please try to make it possible to attend the workshop, and definitely it will be really, it will increase your knowledge in this tool. And nowadays, this is the future. I would say that, yeah, you have to learn these new things. Knowledge of SPSS, SS, that is also required. But now we have to focus, along with it, we have to focus also on these new tools, yeah? Because especially for the students also, if you are going somewhere, now all these tools are going to be implemented over there. So if you are having even basic knowledge, because companies will not ask you for the advanced knowledge in both these tools, yeah? Even if you are having the basic knowledge also, that will also help you, yeah? Because they know that at least they don't have to start from scratch, yeah, to train you. But if you are having the basic knowledge, then definitely you can work further. Then company will help you, they will provide you training also, and then you can go further. So I would strongly recommend that the knowledge of both these tools are really necessary, Tableau as well as Power BI. And once you work with both the tools, then also you know that what is the difference between these two tools. Okay, so currently we are starting with this Tableau, then we'll be also focusing on this Power BI. So you can attend the sessions, both the workshops, I would say, one by one.
Yeah, so I think now there is no question from the participants.
Yeah.
So once again, I would like to thank you, sir, because since you have connected to Germany and given your valuable time and valuable insight on the big data and Tableau, and you have satisfactory answer all the queries from the participants. So thank you so much, sir. And I also would like to thank all the participants to attend this entire webinar and make it more interactive by asking your queries and the questions. So which is also useful to us. Like somebody has asked that how to connect this with the Python. So that is also this kind of questions we also would like to have, so that that we have to practice those things. So once again, thank you everyone. मैंने YouTube का भी लिंक शेयर किया है, सो यू आर रिक्वेस्टेड टू सब्सक्राइब दैट बिकॉज़ वी आर गोइंग टू अपलोड दिस सेशन रिकॉर्डिंग. सो इन केस समबडी वाज हैविंग द प्रॉब्लम विद द इंटरनेट और ड्यू टू सम रीजन दे वर नॉट एबल टू अटेन इट, देन दे विल बी एबल टू गेट द रिकॉर्डिंग ऑफ द सेशन. सो आई हैव ऑलरेडी शेयर्ड द YouTube लिंक, आई एम अगेन शेयरिंग इट एंड देन वी आर क्लोजिंग द सेशन. सो थैंक यू एवरीवन, नाउ वी आर क्लोजिंग द सेशन एंड सी यू इन द वर्कशॉप. Yeah.
Thank you, Hiren sir. Thank you for providing me a platform to interact with all the participants. And let us now work on our workshop. Yeah. And looking forward for the workshop. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Thank you all. Thank you all, dear participants, and even some of my ex-students and ex-colleagues. And I'm also happy to see my father over here. So thank you all once again, and hope to see you all soon in our workshop. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Okay, bye-bye. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Bye-bye.
Yeah, bye-bye. Thank you.